Hi, hello. How are you today? Okay, so I see the energy is quite low now because after the lunch, 2:30. So I'm going to do something before we start, and I want your full participation in that, okay? Something completely different. So please stand up, okay? I got a friend who is a DevOps, and he's like German, and you know, he say DevOps are not fun. And I say, come on. So I want to prove him that DevOps are fun, and I want to do a short dance with all of you, and I want you to participate in that, okay? So let's see how that's gonna work. Come on, guys, come on, we need to wake up. Do something different. There is a reason for that. Thank you so much for doing that. I know it was a bit uncomfortable for some of you, and you're not used to these kind of things. I can see in your faces. Well, the reason I did that is because that was a disruptive change. Something completely out of the box, different, out of the normal thing. And guess what? A lot of disruptive changes are happening in the APM industry. Also in the DevOps industry. I want to see by hands, how many of you were doing containers 7 years ago? No hands. 5 years ago. 2013. Come on. Three years ago. Yeah? Now, how many of you are doing containers today? Please raise your hands. You see, disruptive changes are happening in this industry. In DevOps, application, cloud, now we got Docker, Kubernetes, PaaS, so many things happening now, okay? And that was the purpose of this exercise, just to raise the energy, because come on, if I want to be in a conference where it's so bored, it's lies, the energy will be too low, people is not engaged, yes or no? And I have a different style. Maybe it's my Latin passion, okay? So, yeah, about 5 years ago, there were a lot of tools in the APM industry, but I can tell you that now this market is consolidating, yeah? Now we start to see the true leaders in this market, and why is that happening? So, and I want to start with that because in AppDynamics, we've been leading the industry of the APM. And we born with the mindset, with the goal of doing a disruptive change. Traditional IPM tools, they're focused in solving one problem, silo tools, one problem. And then they were not ready for the new ecosystem. Talking about cloud, talking about microservices, containers, all of that. And since the very beginning of this company, Joyti Bansati, the founder, he said, I want to solve the new problems of this, of the industry, of the IT industry. Okay? So thank you for those who participate. I wanna acknowledge, I think there was one person in the room that was really engaged and dancing and really, really happy. So I want to acknowledge that person. I give this book. It's called The Devil's Handbook. Please take this book. He was really engaged. He was like, yeah, this is my time. Please show me camera.
Professional dancer, by the way.
Yeah, I can see that.
Semi-professional.
So, you see, that's why when you participate, sometimes you get some rewards, okay? Good. So, again, thank you for being here. I know there's a lot of tracks. It's a big conference, but I really say thank you for being here and spend this time with us. So now, let me tell you a little bit about me, as as I was introduced. I've been in the industry for at least 18 years. My background is technical, so I was sitting there maybe the last year in another conferences. So I was developing software, mostly in Java, and a lot of banking experience. And I can tell you that I didn't know anything about APM tools until 2 years ago, when I was in one of the top banks in the UK, Santander, and we were developing a payments platform out of, like, from scratch, entirely new platform, Greenfield project, Java 8, microservices, PaaS, Pivotal Cloud Foundry, AWS, like top technology for a bank. And it was a big challenge. And I remember the stakeholders asking me, hey, we're gonna need some kind of monitoring tool. And I was like, okay, let me have a look to the market, see what, you know, what we have available. And at that point, at Dynamics, I found that something was different about these guys. The very first thing I noticed is that they were talking about business transaction, business journeys, user journeys. It was not like, in my mind, monitoring was about CPU, response, usage, memory. You know, that was the kind of the metrics that I have in my mind for monitoring. But these guys, they were talking something different. And that would really catch my attention. So with the, we call that POV, because it's not a POC. It's not a proof of concept, yeah? Proof of concept is when you go and download the agents and you do something on your own. Proof of value is when you actually solve a problem, okay? In pre-production, in development environment, in production environment. And we did a POV, and we saw, like, oh, we're getting value so quickly in just in less than 2 weeks. And we are already monitoring an application, you know, having some metrics, business metrics, and we were starting to understand how to use this completely different tool. And that was something that really caught my attention. I spent like almost 2 years on that customer, and then I decided to jump to the dark side, the business and sales. So now I move to AppDynamics as a senior solution engineer, and I'm enjoying a lot because I see now how the companies, or especially technical people, they stay on the other, you know, the old way of doing things. So my purpose today is showing you guys that there is a different way of monitoring applications, that it can make your job better, and also it can have a true impact on the business. Because at the end of the day, technology without a business purpose doesn't make any sense. So we can have the best orchestration, the best technology, the best APIs, the best response, but if there is no business, okay, guys, no more business, find another contract, find another job or whatever. So how many times that happened for you in your life, that you gotta find a new company, a new job, because things happen, yes or no? So technical people usually don't see this. They don't see that there is an impact on the business that is related with the IT. And this is exactly what AppDynamics helps customers. To make the gap closer between the business and the IT. And that's what I'm gonna show you today, okay? And also at the end of the talk, we will talk about some news, more very, very specific for DevOps and orchestration and containers. So I'll go that in at the end of the talk, okay? So far, so good. Are you excited or not?
Yes.
Yes, come on, now you see how it's with me, it's different, yes or no?
Yes.
Good. Okay, so I was talking about the AppDynamics do things differently, yeah? But there is something like we are facing real challenges. We're facing applications where are more distributed. There are more dependencies. Oh, we got an API there. We got a database here. Relational, non-relational databases, container, faster cycles. So now we are in agile mode. We're deploying every day. So like every day, what is this? Come on. And even in banks or top corporations, they want to incorporate these practices. They want to be able to deliver applications faster. And there are now new challengers. I don't want to name this bank, but there is a bank, virtual bank. They released a mobile application in the UK, and it's been so popular. And then the other day, I was having a new business meeting with Santander, and they have the channels. The channels is the mobile application. And then I went to the Apple store to see the online banking application. And I saw 4 releases in a year. It's like every 3 months. And then I compare with this other bank, virtual bank, a startup, a challenger, and I count like 45 releases in less than 6 months. These guys are releasing 2 times a week. 2 times a week. That's crazy. It's crazy for you guys because you, most of you, I'm assuming you, can I see by hands who work in the continuous delivery, like pipelines, continuous, could you please raise your hand? Good, so now, can I see by hands people that work more on the infrastructure, like servers, provisioning? Can you see my hands? So, do we have any people here like developers or, good. Okay, and do we have anyone for business? Any guy? Business? He doesn't want to raise his hand, like. So, you see, now this is good because we had a mix of audience, you know, different people from different backgrounds. That's really good, I like that. So, faster cycles, more dependencies, and then more complicated environments, more distributed. Cloud, hybrid clouds. So you got a public, you got some public services inside a private network. So complicated. Yes or no? Good. So then how do you follow what your customer does? How can you keep tracking what they're doing or what your system is doing? So difficult, yeah? And because, okay, so customers, they say, okay, they hit the server, a network piece, an application, a container, public cloud. So the journeys, the transaction map is becoming very complex, very complex. So, and then AppDynamics say, but wait a minute, even in this complexity, there is something that haven't changed, which is the concept of transaction. What is a business transaction? So business transaction, all of you have bought something on internet, yeah? So, and then the moment we do checkout, okay? The moment we do login, the moment we do save, yeah? Internally, that might be a post in an API or whatever, but it's a transaction. It's a business transaction, and that business transaction is part of a user journey. You start from a login, you move for a review catalog or whatever, get catalog, view details, add to car, check out. Yes or no? So that is the only constant in this industry. Even if it's a mobile application, you got a business transaction as well, because mobile is, at the end of the day, they're just a client calling a server application. Yes or no? So, good. And then, what is the issue with these business transactions and distributed environments? It's that we are used to have silo tools. And silo tools, okay, you got one tool for monitoring the network. Okay, then you got another tool for monitoring the database. You got another tool for the infrastructure. And you got another tool for the logs. You got another tool for the middleware. And da-da-da, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Yes or no? So can I see by hands, you know, people that is technical. So if you can count in your mind, say, do you use 5 tools on your, you know, for monitoring your business? Please raise your hand. Now, do you use 10 tools? Please raise your hand. You see that? So more complex. Now we gotta learn how to use this one and that one and that one. And it's so difficult. They also release new versions, new features, so it's getting more and more complicated. And the other problem is that when there is a problem, you need to go and see 10 tools. So is the problem here? No. There is a problem here? No. Is a problem here? No. And then at the end, you're getting crazy. Now, how many of you are on call or have been in call, on call? And especially when you get this call at 2 o'clock in the night or a weekend, I'm like, what am I gonna do now? I need to go and check this, check that, check that. Yes or no? That's the typical things we do. We do. Are you still doing? I'm not anymore. Yeah, I moved to the dark side. I told you guys. So no more coding, no more deployments, no more on call. Yeah. So okay. So silo tools struggle to identify the issues. Yeah. Where are the issues? Where are the issues? And where is the yellow? Where is the red? Yeah. What is? Because sometimes you say, oh wait a minute. Users are complaining because something is going slow or something is going bad. And then you got the infrastructure guy and say, servers are fine, 10%. It's not my fault. Must be the database. They do that because they know you only look into one tool and one thing of the problem. Yeah? But you don't see the full picture. You're not seeing the full picture. You see that? Okay, so silo teams solve silo problems, okay? So, and then we got these war rooms, yeah? I love that, war rooms. So now I wanna ask some questions and, you know, so people participate. So how many of you, please raise your hand, have been in a war room trying to solve a production issue? Yeah? Almost most of you, almost. Okay, now. We don't have microphone. Do we have microphone, guys? Thank you. So could you please, I want this to be, you know, like interactive, because this is how we're going to get value, all of us. Yeah, if we share and then we see how can we, you know, connect these ideas. So could you please somebody share with us how is the experience of a war room? Yeah. Or what did you learn? What happened? What was your, you know, learning from being in a war room, please? Can somebody participate? Yeah? You want to do it? Yeah? No? So what about the dancer? Come on, man.
I haven't been in a war room. So
no? But I think your colleague has been. So he's really, he wants to share his experience. Come on, don't be shy.
He's a one-man war room.
Come on, good. So please, just share. Share with us, just, you know, what is a war room for you? How was that? How has been in a war room for you, please?
It almost always starts out as absolute chaos, with just every silo trying to rule themselves out without even looking at anybody else.
Yeah.
So a bit of blame storming is always a good way to start. Once we're kind of underway and people are actually looking at problems, it's usually quite a long time before find commonalities between the systems where the problems could actually exist. So if you're looking at probably half an hour of just getting people in sync. And from there it's what's actually gone wrong. I was at an APAC telco during a very large mobile phone vendor's release of their very popular new mobile phone,
mm-hmm.
and their sales system went down on morning of, and I think they were down for almost 3 hours.
Oh my God!
Just the releases are in the papers, it's in the ads are on the TV, go on the website now,
oof.
And they were down, and we were running around trying to find a way to even figure out where the problem was.
The pressure.
Yes, and you've got management standing around, everyone's like, every 2 minutes, hey,
what's going on?
Yeah, have you fixed it yet? Have you fixed it?
If it's fixed, it's fixed.
Yeah, that's been my experience. So.
Thank you so much. Please, a round, big of applause. Yeah, thank you so much. Somebody else, please, you want to share? You know what, it's a war room experience, something that you want to, you know, share with this audience? Come on, I'm sure that's important. You want to participate? I'm kind of like, you know, you want to participate and I kind of point to people. Good. Look, thank you so much for that. I didn't get your name, sorry.
James.
So, look, this is what I got from, you know, from your testimony. It's like chaos. Chaos, like, yes, we got, you know, a lot of people in a room trying to figure out the problem. And there is not a way to order, you know, what is first, what comes first, what comes second. So it's a big problem, yeah? So blaming. It's the database, guys. I'm pretty sure it's the database. My server is pretty good, yeah? And then the database say, no. Oracle will never die. It's impossible, yeah? There's no way. That must be the application, guys. Must be the application, guys. And then we got the developers. I saw some developers here, yeah? So my code is perfect. I run TDD. My code doesn't have any errors. It's never fails. Yeah? I retested. And I done my TDD as well, all my tests. It's bulletproof, yeah? And then what's going on? So in the meantime, the business people, they're eating their nails like, how long is gonna take? How long is gonna take? When is gonna be solved? Yeah, they're like basically losing business. And now what's the problem of this is, think about the user experience that now the users are getting, they're getting today. Talking about the Facebooks, the Googles, the Spotify's, the, you know, Netflix. Come on, that never fails. So now people, their standards are really high. They say, oh, no, this is taking 1 second too low. This is too slow. And they're complaining so easy now. And not only that, now they got these powerful tools in their hands, which are phones. They can tweet or they can post, oh, this service is so bad, this application is so bad, 1 star, and there is a brand reputation. Yeah, there is a brand impact, yes or no? Yeah, and how do you recover from those brand impacts? I've seen businesses falling down for days because they couldn't recover from an outage that it was, you know, so bad for the business, yeah? And we try to do our jobs, developers, DevOps, we try to be responsible, we try to, you know, have everything automated, we try to, you know, provisioning faster, all of that, we try to do our best job, but at the end of the day, if there is an impact on the business, no job or no, or there's simply no business, okay? So then that's another difficult thing, how you connect one problem here with another problem here, you know what I mean? So you can say, oh, wait, I saw an error on the logs. You know, somebody is in Kivana or in Splunk, he's saying, I saw an error on the log. Oh, yeah? And then I say, what it says? And then, this is not related. So difficult to see the connection between one thing here and another thing there. That's very difficult. And obviously, if you are developing or deploying or delivering complex services, that have complex business logic, that's even more difficult to track, because now it has the business aspect, yeah? So 1 hour to sync, I like that. Man to hour? So if you have an organization with 10 people working for 2 hours to solve an issue, how much money you're draining there, yeah? It's a business impact, yes or no? Good. Now, also, think about, is there a way to prevent those outages? It's like we are working in reactive mode and not reactive programming or reactive front end. It's like something happened and then we react to that rather than being proactive. Yeah, being proactive. So just, okay, anticipate to the problems, okay, and say, oh, wait a minute. I'm starting to notice something is not working fine. Something is degrading. What's going on? Oh, maybe the database, the connection pools, the thread pools, maybe it's the cache, maybe it's something that it's, if I could have a tool that can, you know, advise me or alert me when something starts to degrade, I believe we can prevent outages. Yes or no? Raise your hand if you agree with me. Good. Thank you. So at the end of the day, what we want is to help the business, is to have a seamless user, like really great user experience, business flowing, and then everyone happy. Yeah, that's what we want. And that's what the business people want. They want to have the best IT, so then they can use the best, and they can have leverage to, you know, do whatever they want in the business context, okay? So thank you so much for that intervention. It was really, really useful. Thank you so much. Okay, so now, yeah, we were talking about the, you know, the other, the business room, where they're like, oh my God, how long this is gonna take? Yeah. So the conclusion here is that we gotta move fast, yes, because customers are moving fast. They have higher expectations. They want to have the best service. It's not only about, oh, this application responds faster. They also want a good-looking design. So it's, you know, because they're getting used to this user experience. You know what I mean? This level of standards. Yeah. Then we have to follow everything. The complexity keeps growing. Yeah. Tomorrow, I don't know, in 10 years, there's gonna be another speaker talking. How many of you have seen virtual containers, you know, in, you know, like maybe some glasses, then you can see the containers. I don't know, something crazy might happen or it will appear. We don't know. Something can happen in this industry and other disruptive chains. Yeah? So we will see. Now, we gotta focus on what matters most. And what I mean by that is, what is the root cause of the problem? I want to know what is the root cause of the problem. Where is the problem? Okay? So now, how can we solve these problems? And how AppDynamics helps you to do modern application monitoring. So, okay, so now, how are we going to move fast? How are we going to follow everything? How are we going to focus on what matters most? So, come on. Seems like it's not working. Okay, so then, in this complex environment, in this distributed environment, what we're gonna do is we're gonna deploy some agents. Okay, so maybe some of you are familiar with this, the concept of agents. So, agent. An agent, if you're familiar with Java, okay, so it will be like a jar file, will be another library, let's say, that is gonna be loaded on your application server, let's say your Tomcat server, and when the application starts, it's loaded, so the agent is there, okay? So you're gonna put these lightweight agents in your applications. Well, we have agents for different purposes. We got agents for, you know, servers. We got agents to monitor databases. We got agents for monitoring mobile applications. Yeah, SDK. We'll say SDK, not an agent, but an SDK. You know, to help you monitor mobile applications as well, web pages. So good. So now we got those agents. These agents can be deployed as well in containers and private cloud or whatever, and then those agents are going to auto-instrument your application. And this is automatic, yeah? No code interventions. You don't have to go and change your class to tell, or your code to tell the APM that, hey, please monitor this. Because some of the APM tools require that. Bear in mind, you gotta keep coding, changing your code. You gotta change the instrumentation as well. It's It's a problem, yeah? It's not going to make your life easier, a developer's life easier. So completely automatic, okay, out of the box. Let's see if now the pointer is working. Oh, yeah, good. Now, those agents, they're gonna see every transaction, okay, going through your infrastructure, your topology, your architecture, okay? And then we're gonna correlate that transaction across that journey, okay? So how we do that? Well, it's a technical piece, but let's say we're gonna inject a header, you know, like an ID. We're gonna inject something in that transaction that can this comes from A, then C, this comes from B, so they can correlate it, okay? This is super important, super important. Why is that? Because you're gonna have end-to-end visibility, so you know exactly what is the flow, what's happening with that transaction, okay? Good. So now, what else are we gonna do? So, you remember when I say to you guys, if it's possible to have a tool that help me to prevent outages, being proactive. Okay, so now, because we're gonna measure how long it takes from A to, let's say, C, well, this usually takes, let's say, 800 milliseconds. This is the normal behavior, okay? So now, we're gonna baseline that, you know? We're gonna baseline that. So now we know that this takes 800 milliseconds. Now, what's gonna happen is, we're gonna have more requests, more users, more traffic, whatever, okay? And then something is gonna deviate from normal at some point, because something is happening, something is degrading. And that's when we're gonna identify those transactions, those business transactions that deviate from the normal standard line, okay? And when something deviates, because it's an anomaly, it's not the normal thing, it could be a slow transaction, a very slow transaction, okay? And obviously errors are errors. So errors, the moment something broke here, okay, we capture that and then we know, look, there was an error here. And then we use this concept of transaction scorecard. You can see out of your 100 transactions, how many are normal, how many are slow, how many are very slow, how many errors, yeah? And then infrastructure people, ops people, ops team, or DevOps or whatever, or developers can go and see and find, filter those transactions by that criteria and say, okay, those are the errors. Boom, those are the very slow. And then you can start to dig into and figure out what's going on. Now, we use as well machine learning. And I got this question a lot from customers. Like, what happened if Friday in the night we have more traffic and that's normal for us? Well, machine learning tell us that, okay, look, normal on Friday night, it is 1 second, not 800. So what's the point of sending an alarm, you know, to the on-call people because it's deviating 200 milliseconds? And this, and a lot of APM tools have static thresholds, yeah? So then what's gonna happen is, you gotta go and change the threshold, or maybe program some dynamic threshold in order to, you know, to don't have false alarms. You know what I mean? Everybody understands that?
I've had that pain.
Oh, please, can I have the microphone? I like when people participate. Thank you so much.
At a reasonable size Australian airline, mm-hmm. They like to do sales on occasion. They just put a new WAF in, and they tuned it all up during their normal period. And their salespeople 2 weeks later announce a sale just after it's gone into blocking mode. And of course, sale triggers at midnight, everything blocked. Every single customer's getting, you're, you know, trying to attack our site, go away. So, yeah, non-dynamic thresholds are a lot of pain.
It reminds me to the people that go into the trading world and they don't have stop loss or those kind of things, you know. So, good. Thank you so much again, please. Big round of applause. Thank you. So, and this is a good thing. If you have to, you sometimes IT people, they're not aligned with the business and neither with the marketing teams. So we got a customer, you know, Car Warephone House. It's they sell phones in the UK, yeah? And we help them that most of the big business for them comes on Black Friday. Can you imagine how many phones they sell on Black Friday when everybody's giving phones to, you know, people, whatever, friends, family, whatever? They do a lot of business only in one day. So, of course, if you want to be ready for these kind of scenarios, you need to understand what it's the normal behavior on that scenario. Yeah? And we're talking about production. This is real production. It's not a development or pre-production where you don't have that load. You don't have that load in these environments usually. So, and that's where, I mean, if you can have a tool that can see the behavior in production, that's how you're gonna understand how your business perform. Yeah? And now, what I have seen is people saying, we need more AWS power. Yeah, and they escalate. Yeah, because we have to escalate. And there are so many companies overspending money in AWS. Yes or no? Yeah? Because they don't know exactly how much is the normal and how much they can handle. Yeah? So it's a big thing. And you can save money out of that if you know. Yeah? And therefore, you can grow when you need it. You can scale when you actually need it. Yeah, so that's the important things of these. Is the important thing is to understand what is your normal behavior. I want to talk about as well. It's quite a bit. I think it was 45 minutes.
15 past.
It's only 30 minutes.
It's 15 past.
Yeah. Okay. So I thought I have 45 minutes, but it seems like I only have 30. Okay, good. Okay, I'm gonna speed up quickly. Yeah. Then we got a tool that can allow you guys to figure out the root cause of this problem. Yeah, because the moment we got this alert, we can show you what is the root cause of that, and then you can see if it's an HTTP problem, database call, anything. I wanna try if I can, you know, demo some of that. Yeah, if not, we are on the fifth floor, and I obviously welcome you guys to come and have a look on the demo. If you want to, you know, give us your details, we can, you know, contact you guys. We've got a huge team in the UK and also in Europe, so there is a lot of things we can do for you guys. Okay, so now, another thing, important thing is to have a low overhead in production. Yeah, so I want to have this tool, but I also want this tool perform properly in production, because if not, I'm going to have another problem, yeah? And that's very important. And not all the APM vendors does it. Some of them, they capture everything, and then what's going on is when the traffic increases, they stop capture, yeah? Or they simply, you know, take a lot of memory out of your boxes. So we're pretty smart on that too, because I like to use the analogy of the motorway. Yeah, so you got the speed cameras. So the speed cameras, they don't take pictures of every car. They monitor every car. Yeah, so it's like we monitor every transaction. Only those transactions that, you know, are anomal. They are anormal. That's when we take the full picture. That's when we take the full snapshot. So that makes the overhead in production really, really low. Okay, so what's going on? Okay, so now with this way, we can also deploy thousands of agents. We have customers that have deployed 15,000 agents in complex environments. So we are meant to scale. And another piece that I wanna talk is, because we are inside your applications, now we can do business intelligence in real time. We're talking about companies like, okay, if you're monitoring everything, can I tell the agent to collect, for example, number of payments, amount, total amount, impact in payments, you know, payments by segment. You know, when I see the payments by this segment or that segment. I mean, name it any sector, any type of application, you can have some business intelligence around. And you can also baseline those metrics and put it on dashboards. Okay, it's fully configurable. And then you can create business dashboards and see the correlation with the IT. So you have a lot of things to talk, guys. And time flies when you're engaged. But at the end of the day, what we want to see is the journey of even a specific user. Yeah? Even a journey of a specific user, because we can capture, if you want, a specific data. So, oh, this user was having a bad experience today. Yeah? So, look, this is an example of a dashboard that is showing some business metrics as well and some traditional, you know, like response, for example, time response. And what I want to do, guys, is I want to do a demo. I know we're quite short of time. And so do you have any question up to this point? Because I don't think we're going to have enough time to do as well the demo and talk about the Kubernetes, because we now have fully support for Kubernetes. We can see all the information of the nodes and, you know, the clusters. And you can correlate as well the IT problems with the Kubernetes and end-to-end visibility as well. And the same for Docker and these containers. So do you have any other questions, please?
Do you have to have predefined
pre-built agents for particular software, or do you have agents that will just parse through custom, say, structured data formats to for a proprietary application that you have no idea about?
So, thank you for that question. So, we have some agents for different technologies. So, we got agents for Node.js, for Java, .NET, PHP. We recently now launched agents for mainframe and SIP as well, which is something that no other vendors have. So the agents are linked to a technology, okay? But then we also have some SDK for C++, so for example, for IoT, Internet of Things. Now we can start to monitor as well things that are completely isolated, yeah? So I don't know if that answered your question.
Not quite. It's I'm talking about, say, I have a lot of structured logging data that has all the information that you mentioned is all already in there. What is required is something that would then combine this information and pull out, allow sort of analytics and intelligence based okay. on that data to graph it, because some things like Kibana is very difficult to graph. You know, apart from maybe you can graph individual metrics, but to build complex dashboards is difficult. Something that would...
George, I can answer that now. I understand what you mean now. So the agents report as well to the business analytics agent, to the analytics engine that we call the business intelligence. So once the data is there, you can do queries. And you can do queries without any code.
The application is generating the data already.
Yeah, but you tell the agents to capture the specific data. So, because at the end of the day, it's one object, you know, one piece of data flow, you know, like moving across your application. So, if I have a payment object, a payment contains properties. I can go to the AppDynamics controller, which is a web application where the agents report the data. Say, you go to the controller and say, look, I want you to collect this property that is inside this object, okay? Now, once you got the data, it's collected, then you can start to do analytics. So, okay, could you do a sum of all the payments that are error, where the transaction was error? Yeah, and then you got a metric, and that metric, you can pull that metric, put it in a dashboard, you can have an API, you can put it in another website if you don't want to have it on the controller. We support on-premises or SaaS as well. So now that answered the question? Good. Any other question, please? And I'm sorry that we overextend. So I truly, guys, invite you to come on the breaks, upstairs, fifth floor. We can show you some demos. We can show you the Kubernetes happening, you know, because I know we're already out of the time. And thank you so much for participating.